السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: قل إن كنتم تحبون الله فاتبعوني يحببكم الله ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم والله غفور رحيم. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, first and foremost I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a slave of Allah attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. To proceed in this short talk that I have been given today, I wish to touch on the sunnah of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also in regard to how important it is to love our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So please remember salawat whenever I mention his beautiful name. My beloved Shaykh Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says in regard to mahabba, in regard to love, and we aren't talking about some illicit love, rather we are talking about the purest form of love, that is to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our beloved maker, and likewise to love our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In regard to this pure love, Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim rahimahullah, he says some beautiful words, words that deserve to be inscribed in gold. He says, إِذَا غُرِسَتْ شَجَرَةُ الْمَحَبَّةِ فِي الْقَلْبِ إِذَا غُرِسَتْ شَجَرَةُ الْمَحَبَّةِ فِي الْقَلْبِ, that if the tree of love, if the tree of love is planted in an individual's heart, وَسُقِيَتْ بِمَاءِ الْإِخْلَاصِ, and if that particular tree of love is watered with the water of ikhlas, with the pure water of ikhlas, wa mutaba'ati al-habib, and likewise the following of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahu Akbar, what a blessed tree, athmarat anwa' al-thimar, that beautiful blessed tree would begin to start giving beautiful fruits, it would start benefiting that individual, it would start giving out fruits. And what would happen to that tree? Asluha thabitun fi qarar al-qalb. The foundation of that tree, in other words, the roots of that tree would be firmly rooted in that individual's heart. Wa far'uha muttasilun bi sidratil muntaha. Allahu Akbar. And its branches would grow strong and high, so much to the extent that it would reach the sidratul muntaha, that is the border where Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam even could not cross, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam passed on to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, this beautiful statement of his highlights many aspects, but I'll just be talking about the part where he says, سُقِيَتْ بِمَاءِ الْإِخْلَاصِ وَمُتَابَعَةِ الْحَبِيبِ, that this tree has to be watered with ikhlas, and then mutaba'ati al-habib, that is to follow our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For it is indeed of utmost importance loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, likewise following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is part of Iman, O slaves of Allah. It is part of Iman. It is part of Iman because of the hadith which is recorded in Bukhari and Muslim. Anas radiallahu anhu, he says, anna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam aqal. Listen carefully to the words of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. La yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabba ilayhi min waladihi wa walidihi wa nasi ajma'in. Allahu Akbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that none of you all have truly brought in Iman. Look at the words. Strong words indeed. None of you all have truly brought in Iman until, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying this, until I become the most beloved unto that individual. None of you have truly brought in Iman until I become the most beloved unto you, until I become the most beloved, even more beloved than your own children, your parents, and all of humanity. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. This is why scholars of Islam, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, they attach so much of importance to loving Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and likewise following our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another narration which is recorded in Bukhari. Umar radiallahu anhu, he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, Ya Rasulullah, the hadith goes along the lines of these words, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, I love you more than anything in this world except for myself. I love you more than anything in this world except for myself. Our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may my mother and my father be ransomed for him. He says, No, Ya Umar. I have to be more beloved unto you even than your own self. Umar radiallahu anhu then says, if that's the case, Ya Rasulullah, then you are more beloved to me than even myself. Allahu Akbar. Now the question could arise as to why or how did Umar radiallahu anhu immediately change his statement. At the spur of the moment, he changed his statement. And the most beautiful explanation in regard to that, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, is the explanation of Al-Imam Al-Khattabi, rahimahullah. He says that hub, that love is divided into two. There is hub tabi'i and hub ikhtiyari. We have something known as hub tabi'i, and then we have something known as hub ikhtiyari. Let me explain. Hub tabi'i is that natural ingrained love that we have for our own selves. For example, as examples bring about clarity, none of us would jump out of a high building. Why? Because we value our lives. We value our lives. This is a hub tabi'i. We love ourselves naturally. We aren't going to put our lives at risk or in danger because that natural love is ingrained in us. On the other hand, hub ikhtiyari comes about due to some reason. For example, why do we love our parents? We love our parents, it's natural in a sense, but at the end of the day, we love them because we know all that they have done for us. That love is brought about because of a reason. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was highlighting to Umar radiallahu an that he has to cultivate hub ikhtiyari. Hub ikhtiyari. Not hub tabi'i, not natural love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but hub ikhtiyari, because there is a reason. For if you love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that would become a means for your salvation from the blazing fire of Jahannam. If you love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than anything in this world, that would become a means of you being free from Jahannam. Allahu Akbar. So this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Umar radiallahu anhu understood the minute Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam highlighted it, and he immediately changed his statement, because he understood that if he brings about hub ikhtiyari of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is going to save him from the blazing inferno of Jahannam. May Allah the Almighty save us all from the fire of Jahannam. So my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, now we move on to the relationship between the Qur'an and the Sunnah. The relationship between the Qur'an and the Sunnah. The Quran and the Sunnah always go hand in hand. That is something that has to be internalized well by us. The Quran and the Sunnah always go hand in hand. Now, what is the status of Sunnah? Sunnah is al-wahi, as Allah the Almighty says in the Noble Quran in regard to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, he does not speak out of his own desires, he does not speak out of his own pockets. In huwa illa wahyun yuha, whatever he says is divine inspiration from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is wahy. And in regard to the relationship between Quran and Sunnah, they go hand in hand. If you ever think that you come across a contradiction between the Quran and the Sunnah, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, know that it is either a problem with your understanding of the Quran and the Sunnah, it is because you do not have the proper understanding of the Quran or the Sunnah, or else the hadith is weak. Or else the hadith is weak or fabricated. If not, if the hadith is authentic, if the hadith is authentic and your understanding is proper, the Quran and Sunnah go hand in hand explaining one another. Explaining one another. Now, in regard to the term a Sunnah, in general, we have something known as Lughatan and Shar'an in the books of Ahadith, in the books of Fiqh. You have something known as Lughatan and Shar'an. In other words, a lexical or linguistic definition of a term, and then we have a technical definition of a term. Let me give you an example. If you were to take the term As-Salah, the term As-Salah, this also has a Lughatan, a lexical definition, and likewise a technical definition. The lexical definition of salah is prayer. And when I say prayer, I'm not talking about the prayer that's coming to your mind, but rather I'm talking about dua. I'm talking about invocation, where you raise your hands and pray to Allah the Almighty. That is the lexical meaning of as-salah. But as for the technical meaning of as-salah, is the salah that you know. The five salah or the few raka'at that you pray in, the few units of salah that you offer, for example, for subah or for dhuhr or for maghrib or for isha, for asr. Basically, it is a set of actions, it is a set of prescribed actions that begin from takbiratul ihram and end with the taslim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. This is the shar'i or the technical definition of a salah. So likewise, Sunnah has two definitions, lexical and technical. Now what is the lexical or the linguistic definition? The linguistic definition of Sunnah is a way. The linguistic definition of Sunnah is a way or a path. A path. And that's why we say the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now as for the shar'i or the technical definition of Sunnah, it is divided into four categories, which we will touch briefly and swiftly. Four categories. Category number one, Sunnah Qawliya. All of the statements of our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sunnah in its shar'i, in its technical definition, entails Qawliya, that is the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Fi'liya, the actions of our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Taqririya, his approval, the approvals of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the sanctions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And finally, we have one more category which is known as Sunnah Tarkiyya. This many people are not aware of. This is all of that which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left. Due to him leaving it, we also leave it following our master alayhi salatu wa sallam. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let's quickly touch on each category. Category number one, Qawliya, where we say the statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is basically all of the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. All of the ahadith come under the category Qawliya. And this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, until today, Allah the Almighty has used great scholars to protect the science of ahadith, to protect the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where we have a complete science devoted to verifying ahadith, in regard to the chains of narrators, in regard to the authenticity of the ahadith, we have a complete science. Allah the Almighty brought about personalities, the likes of Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, Imam Muslim rahimahullah, great giants, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, for the sole purpose of protecting the ahadith of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our nation is known as the nation of the sanad. In other words, the nation of the chain of narrators. Basically, we have encyclopedias, books that have all of the biographies of the narrators. If you were to take Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, such a great personality, he had all of the hundreds of thousands of ahadith in his head. He had a photographic memory, and not only the hadith, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, he even had the chain of narrators in his head. He even knew each narrator by heart, including his biography. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. For example, if you were to quote a hadith by Imam Bukhari rahimahullah, he would give you the chain of narrators, and then he would say, this narrator is authentic, or this narrator is strong, this narrator is weak, and so on. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam using personalities of that nature. Allahu Akbar. So Sunnah Qawliyah has been established. I hope it is clear. Statements of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, all of which has been recorded and filtered, through which we have authentic ahadith, weak ahadith, and even the fabricated ones have been verified and put aside. So the Sunnah Qawliyah has been established. Now second category, as we have a few minutes remaining, we move swiftly. Sunnah Fi'liyah is the actions of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whatever Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did is basically his sunnah. We follow it and we are rewarded for that. For example, our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray just as you have seen me praying. Pray, it's a command. Pray as you have seen me praying. So we follow our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and pray just as how he prayed. Likewise, in regard to the rituals of Hajj, take your rituals from me, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said. So we also follow the rituals of Hajj, just as how our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam followed it. This is in regard to the fi'liyah, the second category. I hope that is also clear. Now we move on to the third category, sunnah taqririyah. I said that it means the approvals of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He perhaps would not have done it. He may have not given a hadith in regard to it, but he kept quiet about it. That was basically his silence, is his approval. Let me give you an example. Once Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu and Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu, they accompany Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Maymuna radiallahu anha's house, if I'm not mistaken. And they go to her house for a meal. Now whilst they had seated for the meal, a dish was brought and laid by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It looked like meat. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now he is in his wife's house. He outstretches his hand to partake of that dish. Now the women folk who are behind, they started telling one another, we better inform Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that that dish is the meat of al-dhab. I'll translate that. It is the meat of al-dhab. So they informed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, the hadith goes along the lines of these words, ya Rasulullah, that is meat of al-dhab. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam immediately took his hand back. Now what is al-dhab? Dhab, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is a type of a reptile. It is a type of a reptile similar to an iguana, like a lizard. Similar to an iguana. Even here, maybe not in Colombo, but in the outskirts of Colombo, people do consume it. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not like it. He took his hand away. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu an, Allahu Akbar, a great commander. The great commander. He asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, a haramun huwa? You're taking your hand away. Is it haram, ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, no, ya Khalid, it's not haram, but me and my qawm, me and my tribe, or me and my nation, in other words, from where I come from, my area, we don't partake of this. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu, he got the green light, he pulled the dish towards him, and mashallah, he whacked the dish away in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept quiet. He did not show any disapproval in regard to it. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, it is the responsibility of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is upon our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if something haram is happening in front of him, he cannot keep quiet. He cannot keep quiet. Al-amr bil ma'roof wa nahi anil munkar. He has to stop it. So if he kept quiet about it, if he approved of it, it is something that is permitted in our deen. It is something permitted in our deen. So this basically explains the third category, sunnah taqririya. The final category, sunnah tarkiya, which is all of that which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left. Let me give you an example to clarify that. Say for example, in regard to the adhan. Now why is the adhan called out? Basically to inform the Muslimun that it is time for salah. Now we have the adhan for the five salawat. The muazzin calls out the adhan to inform the people that it is time for salah. Now do we have an adhan for salat al-eid? Do we have an adhan for the salah of khusuf and kusuf, luna and solar eclipse? Do we have the prayer we have for luna and eclipse? Eclipses, do we have an adhan for that? No. Even though there is a reason, I mean, for Eid also we need to gather the people, we need to inform the people that it is time for Salatul Eid. But yet we do not call out adhan, even though there is a need for it, because our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do it. He left it, even though there was a need for it, he left it. Because he left it, we also leave it. I hope that is clear. The four categories of sunnah have been explained. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, why we talk about all of this is because many people are not aware. Like say for example, if we say we're talking about the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, many a time if you were to refer through the books of fiqh, if you were to refer through the books of ahadith, they would suddenly say, now basically what are the, for example, let me ask you a question. What are the sources of our deen? I mean, where are the rulings of our deen derived from? The sources are, number one, Quran, the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second resource is a sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Third is ijma'ul ummah, the consensus of the scholars, and the fourth is qiyas. We do not have time to elaborate on all of that, but still, Quran and sunnah basically are the two primary sources. Now when we say sunnah, the word sunnah, what do we mean, or what do the scholars mean? Now I have given you all in a nutshell, when we say sunnah, it basically means these four categories: qawliya, fi'liya, taqririya, and tarkiya. These are the four categories of sunnah through which rulings are derived from. From the statements of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the actions of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from the approvals and the sanctions of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all of that which he left, we also leave. I hope it is clear, and I hope I have used the few minutes that I got to give you all some insight in regard to what sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is. Now my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, before we cap off, let me touch on again in regard to the love of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now coming back to the statement of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah. Now I said that I would be touching on mutaba'atul habib. Now why I went into the definition of sunnah is only if you know about the sunnah, can you follow our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Can you apply mutaba'atul habib? If you do not know, how are you to apply mutaba'atul habib? How are you to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Now in regard to the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is closely linked with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The more we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the more we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, the level we love Allah, the same level we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if the levels of love reduce in regard to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, likewise the levels of love in regard to our beloved maker is naturally going to dwindle and reduce. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, the ayah I recited in the beginning, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, tell your ummah, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ. If you love Allah, that is the purest form of love. Allahu Akbar. If you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow me. If you love Allah, follow me. And what will be the result? يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ, Allah the Almighty will love you. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ And He will forgive all of your sins. وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ Allah the Almighty is the most forgiving, the most merciful. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we live in a time and an era where all of us, we suffer complexes to follow our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are ashamed to portray the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We are ashamed to act upon the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then how will we face our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Qiyamah, my dear respected elders, brothers and sisters in Islam? This love has to be indoctrinated. It has to be ingrained within us, where we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we love our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, just as how the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in loved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah the Almighty, Allah azza wa jal. Let me give you all a narration in regard to the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in had upon him in the last few minutes that I have. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this narration is mentioned by scholars of tariq. They say that close to the death of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he goes to the masjid, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he climbs the minbar. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he climbs the minbar and he addresses the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is close to his death. He's close to passing away to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in gather to hear what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has to say. The hadith goes along the lines of these words. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives out a khutbah that makes their hearts tremble, a khutbah that leaves them crying, tears flowing, their hearts shivering. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam caps off the khutbah by saying, Oh my Sahaba, if any of y'all, in other words, if I have scolded any of y'all, if I have done any wrong unto any of y'all, if I have oppressed any of y'all, please do come and take your retaliation by me, because I want to be free in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to be free in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says this. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they all begin to huddle up together and they all started weeping. They all start crying. How or who is going to take retaliation from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeats that statement saying, come and take your retaliation. He does it a third time. No one, all were crying, all of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they're weeping. But then suddenly one Sahabi stands up. Allahu Akbar. One Sahabi stands up. All of the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in, they wipe their tears away and they're looking at, who is this individual who dares to take retaliation from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They all want to see, who is this man? And lo and behold, it is Ukasha ibn Mihsan radiyallahu anhu. He is standing. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks him, ya Ukasha, do you have something to take from me? Some retaliation? Ukasha radiyallahu anhu says, yes ya Rasulullah. As you emphasized it 2-3 times, I remember once, you were straightening the rows, the sufuf, the rows in the battlefield, during the battle of Badr. You had a stick in your hand, a staff, and you were straightening the rows. At that point, you hit me with that staff, and you hurt me. I want to take retaliation, ya Rasulullah. The Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in could not contain themselves. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu, they get up. يا عكاشة, we stand by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you want to take qisas, if you want to take your retaliation, you take it by us and not on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells his two companions, oh my beloved companions, calm down, calm down. The retaliation is by me. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructs one of the sahabi radiallahu anhu to go to his house and bring that same stick that he used in the battle of Badr, his own stick, to bring it and come so that Ukasha radiallahu anhu will be able to take and get his retaliation. The stick is brought. Ukasha radiallahu anhu takes the stick and goes by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he raises the stick to take his retaliation, and then he informs Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya Rasulullah, on that day when you hit me, I was bare-bodied. So today I want you also to be bare-bodied. Ali radiallahu anhu furiously gets up and says, ya Ukasha, I am in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You take your retaliation by me and not on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hassan, Hussein radiallahu anhu, they both come forward. All of which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, no, my sahaba, calm down, calm down. Along the lines of these words, calm down. The retaliation is by me. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam removes the upper garment that he was wearing. Allahu Akbar. Ukasha radiallahu anhu, he takes the stick by his shoulder. He throws away the stick, runs to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He hugs the bare body of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he starts kissing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he says, ya Rasulullah, ya Rasulullah, who would want to take retaliation by you, ya Rasulullah? All I wanted to do is kiss you, ya Rasulullah. All I wanted to do is let my skin touch your skin. Allahu Akbar, ya Rasulullah. I wanted my skin to be the last skin to touch your body, ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then says, ya Ukasha, either you forgive me or you take your retaliation. Either you forgive me or you take your retaliation. To which Ukasha radiallahu anhu says, ya Rasulullah, I forgive you. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looks at the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in and says, oh my sahaba, if you want to see my companion in Jannah, then look at this man. Allahu Akbar. All of the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhim ajma'in rush to Ukasha radiallahu anhu and begin to kiss him between his eyes and say, glad tidings be unto you, glad tidings be unto you. You are indeed victorious, you are indeed successful, you have won the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, this was the love that the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in had over our master, over our beloved master alayhi salatu wa salam. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, where do we stand when we claim that we love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Finally, as a final note to cap it off, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, the best way to prove that you love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is by emulating his life as your life. It is by adopting his sunnah as your life. It is by bringing his life into your life, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. And from the sunnahs of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes about the greatest sunnah, the greatest responsibility, the responsibility by which this ummah at large has been distinguished specially. And that is the responsibility of da'wah. That is the responsibility of amr bil ma'roof wa nahi anil munkar. By that responsibility, by shouldering that responsibility, only then are we known as the best of nations, as our beloved maker says in the noble Quran, kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas, ta'muruna bil ma'roof wa tanhauna anil munkar. We cannot keep quiet. We have to enjoin good and we have to forbid evil. That is a responsibility this ummah has to shoulder to be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. So my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May Allah the Almighty accept all of our deeds. And may Allah the Almighty help us to involve ourselves in da'wah at a very large scale, and may He help us enjoin good and forbid evil. May Allah the Almighty make us brave, strong Muslimun who cannot keep quiet in front of oppression, who cannot keep quiet in front of evil and vice, who have to enjoin good and forbid evil. May Allah the Almighty forgive all of us.